at the south of Japan, and it's called the Research Institute for Tropical Diseases. And mostly we do researches for dengue and other viruses, influenza, diarrhea-related diseases, as well as antibiotic resistant microorganisms. So we have a research station in Vietnam where some of our lecturers as well as students are centered there. And we also have collaborations with many countries in Asia, including Myanmar, the Philippines, Thai, Indonesia, as some collaborations with Sri Lanka as well, and also other countries in the region. So our department is a WHO collaborating center reference lab for tropical viruses. And we also conduct trainings, especially on diagnosis for flaming viruses, mosquito-borne viruses, with our collaborators as well as countries including Vietnam, and in which they have a recent Zika outbreak starting from 2016. So I will first introduce why it is difficult to develop a dengue vaccine. So as you know, recently Sri Lanka has a very huge dengue virus outbreak in these recent years. So when we are talking about severe dengue, what sort of factors should we look into? Well, these are some of the factors which our group is researching on. We're researching on host, vector, virus, as well as vaccine and therapeutics. So these are some of the works which we are doing with our collaborators, and which is what I would like to introduce to you today. So dengue and Zika, some of you could be familiar with this virus. It is from the family of dengue virus. It is related to West Nile virus, Japanese encephalitis virus, yellow fever virus, and it's also related to somewhat in the distance hepatitis C virus. So this virus cross-reacts, we call cross-reacts in the term of antibodies with other flaming viruses, including the Zika virus, J, and also the West Nile virus. So the situation in many parts of Asia is quite serious. We also see a lot of severe dengue patients in Vietnam, in which they receive treatment including dialysis and also removing of ascites in the hospital. And when dengue is in season, we also see hospitals overflowing with patients, especially in these Southeast Asian nations. So what are we doing in these countries? So one of the main things we look into is how the virus moves between these areas. So this is important to see whether they are moving from continent to continent, and how the virus evolves through time, and how it evolves to adapt to hosts, including human hosts, and also mosquito hosts. So from here we can see that the Vietnamese virus is mostly, there's a huge dengue serotype 1 outbreak in Vietnam recently, and we know Sri Lanka is also facing a dengue 2 outbreak, I think in recent years, and we can see that this virus has been evolving locally since it has been introduced in the country from the early 2000s. And also from the Philippines, we see that there are replacement of serotypes over the years. So over the years, we look into the serotypes which are causing disease, major serotypes, dominant serotypes, which are causing dengue in the region. So recently, we see a spike in the dengue 4 viruses, serotype 4 in the region. And we think this spike is due to the changes in the genotype in the region. So we can see that from the phylogenetic analysis, there's a change from genotype 1 to genotype 2. And we can also see that this virus actually comes in from East Timor from the early 2000s. So this is one of the few things that we are tracing of where the viruses are moving throughout the country and throughout the different regions. And as the site of Myanmar, we see introduction of new genotypes of dengue 3 as well as dengue 4. Well, in this case, these viruses are related to the recent strains from China. So, recently we also see a Zika outbreak in Vietnam. I'm not so sure about the Zika virus situation in Sri Lanka. But in Vietnam, there's a single case of microassembly, and during that time, they weren't sure what is the reason behind this case of microassembly. And we have received a request from the National Infectious Disease Unit in Vietnam. This is it's called NIHE, and it's where we receive a request to determine what sort of infection this child had. And we found that she has been indeed infected with Zika virus when her mother was pregnant. So we are also looking at the Zika virus epidemiology in Vietnam. And currently, we find that there's small outbreaks in the central highland region. And we also have one of my master's students, which is performing the IgM test for some Zika patients. And she will be having a talk tomorrow in the medicine session. And to summarize some of the dengue serotypes and genotypes in Asia and Southeast Asia, we see that there's a changing behavior and characteristics, including virus strain introduction, as well as local evolution of the virus, and also concurrent introduction of other viruses, including Zika virus and Japanese encephalitis virus. So let's return back to why this dengue vaccine is difficult. And here, there's a central question of, does some of the virus cause severe disease? So, for example, some of the studies which would answer how virus strain causes severe disease, including comparison of the dengue virus infection, epidemic trends, serotypes and genotypes, which we have done previously, as well as identification of what type of virus which would grow better in different hosts, for example, mosquito hosts or human hosts. So we did an isolation of different types of dengue viruses from a patient, and we found that there were several strains of virus which grows well in different hosts, for example, mosquito host cell lines or human host cell lines. And so when we identified this virus, this was done by my Vietnamese student, we found that there's two different strains of virus growing inside a single dengue patient. So when we isolate these two viruses from a single patient, we found that one actually grows well in human cell lines as compared to the mosquito cell lines. So what does this mean? It means that the dengue virus could adapt to different growth conditions, either human or in mosquito cell lines, depending on the situation. So it means that the dengue virus could affect the interferon beta pathway to be able to grow better in certain conditions. So to summarize this study, you can see that, for example, this virus strain grows well in human cells, but not in mosquito cell lines. It's able to use the ISGs and interferon beta pathway during the early phases of infection. We are also looking into dengue cases in severe dengue patients. For example, this patient had neurological infection due to dengue virus tree. So we found that by the next generation sequencing, this virus is actually quite different from what of those viruses which are circulating in the serum samples. And when we isolated these two different types of viruses, we also see that they exhibited different growth characteristics in neurological cell lines as compared to the other mosquito cell lines. So to summarize this, it means that the virus is able to grow, show different growth patterns in different vectors as well as hosts. And also, we come back to answer the question of how antibodies is involved in protection against the disease. So what we can see here is the phylogenetic terminal protein. This shows how closely related these viruses are. So when we see that these four dengue serotypes are closely related to each other, which means that the antibodies which are induced by infection of these viruses could also cross-react with different strains of viruses. So one of the central questions are, why are these severe cases of dengue almost often seen in secondary infection and also in example, in dengue virus during prime infection, in which is the first infection, there's no cross-reactive antibodies that could react with the viruses. However, with the secondary infection, with the presence of antibodies that could cross-react with these dengue viruses, these viruses not only increase virus replication, it could also cause increased burden, viremia burden, and could ultimately lead to severe death. Now, we're interested in seeing what sort of immune system, what sort of immunity leads to outcomes including mild dengue, protection, or severe dengue. Now, these are all the important questions to be answered when we are looking into developing a vaccine that is useful. So here, these are some of the works that we have done previously, including development and testing, which could reflect the AD activity as well as the neutralizing activity. We also developed, determined that the assay was useful in determining the neutralizing activity. And we also found that there's a discrepancy in the assays which are currently used for dengue vaccine development and also for dengue research. So this suggests that the Fc gamma receptor expressing cells may better reflect the biological activity of dengue virus neutralizing activity. Now, we have brought this to the WHO as well. And in 2014, they have recommended that these are one of the novel assays that could be used during vaccine development. And so we went on further to examine some of the dengue patients in Japan. And some of you may know that there's no dengue outbreak in Japan, but recently in 2015, there's an outbreak which involved 162 patients during that. And we found that most of them come to the hospital immediately after they had fever. So this is at day zero. Not sure whether it's possible in other places, but here we found that when they come to the hospital initially from day zero, we found that they have high levels of viremia, but all these are prior infection, and so there were no differences in the virus mechanism. But however, when we're using the Fc gamma receptor expressing cells, this is another novel type of assay which measures the antibody levels, we see that there's a difference in the viremia levels between the conventional assay as compared to the normal assay. So to summarize that, why these antibody immune complexes are important in dengue virus study vaccine development, it's because this normal assay is able to detect two different sorts of activity which are important for our immune system protection. So it suggests that these viremia and neutralizing activity, which is important for dengue virus protection, that is measured by the Fc gamma receptor, could be it's may better reflect the levels of in vivo. So we also have a dengue infection model, which is a monkey model. We're working together with the National Institute of Infectious Diseases to develop this model, and we found that it also exhibits certain signs, clinical signs, which is similar to that of dengue patients. We also see that they exhibit high levels of neutralizing antibodies after infection. And this is one of the interesting things, that when we're infecting different patients, or patients were infected with different serotypes of dengue, we normally say that they are immune to other serotypes during secondary infection, because the high levels of antibodies are induced after secondary infection. But when we see in the monkey model, infection with the same genotype also